Campaign 2020 is sponsored by Wisconsin Hospital Association, Quick Trip, Wisconsin Counties Association, Wisconsin Realtors Association, and Wisconsin Operating Engineers Local 139.
Ellie Marsh of Madison is a Democrat running in the 76th Assembly District. The primary is August 11. Ellie, welcome to Wisconsin Eye.
Thanks for having me, Steve. Excited to be here.
Well, when I look at your campaign materials online, you are a big advocate for mental health resources. Talk to me about the need for mental health resources in this tragic time of pandemic, please.
Yeah, appreciate that question. So, I mean, like everybody right now in Wisconsin, we're all feeling some type of emotional stress. I mean, given the economic crisis we have going on and also the public health situation we have going on. And mental health was a concern even pre-pandemic. Our mental health system was already overburdened. We have a major mental health provider shortage in our state. And right now, as we're in this time period, we really need to invest resources to make sure that people have the access to the care and support that they need. One immediate area is telehealth services. So many people are now seeking care through this, what we're doing right here,
sure,
because that's the safest way to do it, and it increases access right now. And we need to make sure our mental health providers are getting reimbursed for these services by health insurance companies so that they can continue this this type of care. So that's one immediate need that we're going to need to address due to the pandemic.
Okay. A couple of questions related to the pandemic. We've seen how hospitals have played frontline roles here. If you're in the assembly voting on the next state budget, what do you think hospitals should get an even greater priority in the next state budget, Allie?
You know, I do. I think hospitals, like any other business right now, is struggling. I know that seems a little counterintuitive because we wouldn't think that industry is struggling right now, but it is. And so I think we do need to support hospitals during this time, you know, especially in areas too that, you know, for example, in rural areas where we need to ensure that our hospitals are able to continue providing services and care and that people have access to support during this time.
Okay, and one more question on the pandemic. Should businesses that follow all safety prescriptions and procedures, health and safety, should they be immune from frivolous lawsuits?
You know, I certainly would be open to some type of protection for businesses that follow all of the recommended guidelines. Now, what concerns me a little bit is that if they're following the CDC's recommended guidelines, we know those have been watered down quite a bit. And so I worry that those are not enough to provide adequate safety measures for residents. Now, I actually just recently was working with the Department of Health Services and, you know, would hope that our businesses are following their guidelines to a T. And, you know, as far as protection from frivolous lawsuits, again, it would be something that I would be open to, but would really need to kind of look at the more details of what a piece of legislation like that would look like.
Okay. From your website, I learned that you're in favor of the governor's special session bills on police training. They would ban chokeholds, ban no-knock warrants, keep a database of officers prone to violence. But you go beyond that. You have got, you want to eliminate cash bail. You want to create a new level of courts for someone under 25 who's accused of a nonviolent crime. So can you talk about your effort to, well, as you said, as you say on your website, end racism?
Yeah, thank you for pointing that out. And on that page, you know, it really is outlining how can we address systemic racism. And like you just mentioned, the criminal legal system is a huge area where we need to prioritize our efforts. And so that's why I went beyond policing reform, because really when we look at racial inequalities in the state of Wisconsin, it unfortunately spans so many areas. So I believe that takes much bolder policy stances. And so for the two pieces you mentioned, the cash bail or eliminating the cash bail, and then also the restorative court system, you know, the goal here is to keep as many individuals out of prison as possible. And to decrease our prison populations, which disproportionately impact communities of color. And that can have just a devastating impact on families. When we talk about mental health, the trauma of having family members incarcerated, if we can do everything possible to prevent that, you know, that is certainly what I am a huge advocate for. And then again, just a quick follow-up on that is also looking at all the other areas, healthcare, education, housing, income inequality, to address this broader issue in our state.
Well, just to clarify, when you say on your campaign materials that you back the concept of defund police, you also say then you want to shift some of those police resources to counselors and other community resources, correct?
Right, absolutely. So, okay. Yeah, my stance is very much is reallocating the funds because, you know, we know far often, and this is especially the case when an individual might be in crisis, struggling with their mental health, it can sometimes be criminalized. And when really that individual needs support from a mental health professional and not be put behind bars. So I would strongly encourage more resources to be put into the mental health field.
What's your position on legalizing both medical and recreational marijuana?
Yeah, I mean, this is a great follow-up question. I'm in full support of legalizing both medical and recreational marijuana. And one of the biggest benefits to that is then decriminalizing it. We know, and this was just in this past April, ACLU came out with a report that showed that Black individuals in Wisconsin were four times more likely to be incarcerated or to be arrested, for marijuana possession than white individuals. So again, that ties directly into the racial disparities in our state. So would be in support of legalization for that reason.
New subject, who should draw the next set of congressional and legislative boundary lines? The Constitution says it'll be drawn by the party in power in the Capitol, but the governor prefers a people's commission. What's your position on that, please?
I am fully supportive of a People's Commission. We also know that's what Wisconsinites want. The majority of Wisconsinites support a nonpartisan commission drawing the maps. I believe that fair maps equals fair elections, or at least fairer elections. We have a lot of work to do to increase voting access, but I believe that that's just absolutely imperative right now.
Governor Evers has said because of the pandemic, we may collect $2 billion with a B less in taxes in this fiscal year. That would present assembly members like you with a clear choice. Do you cut spending or do you raise taxes and fees? How would you approach that dilemma?
Yeah, no, it's true. We're going to be in a really difficult position. One area that I would like to push is an area that's very unique to Wisconsin, and that's regarding our sales tax on online sales. So we have right now an industry that's booming is online purchases, right? It makes sense. We're staying at home. We're trying to stay safe. So we're buying online. And with all of these purchases and the 5% sales tax that's attached to these purchases, right now, because of Wisconsin law that was passed years ago, that sales tax must be used on income tax cuts, whereas many other states can use that sales tax to address their budget deficits. And so I would actually push to change that law to try to help with these efforts, because we know the online purchases are just going to continue to boom. So we need to, I think, really take advantage of that to help support other areas of the state government.
Part of the debate over state taxation deals with our gas tax. It hasn't been increased in 10 years. You know, there's this ongoing discussion, how do we stabilize highway funding? A gas tax, 30.9 cents per gallon. Would you consider a increase in the gas tax, Allie?
You know, I would consider an increase, especially because you're right. You know, we need more resources to fund our infrastructure. I would also, though, really, if we did raise the gas tax, want to see that money also be used to increase public transportation. efforts. So I think we still, we have a lot of work to do in that area. And again, that to provide better transportation throughout our state. So we'd like to see that money allocated that way as well.
Part of the debate over taxes in Wisconsin, property tax. We have some of the highest property taxes, which is why what schools, local governments can levy in property taxes is capped, is limited. Referendums, of course, you can exceed it. As a member of the assembly, would you vote to keep these property tax caps in place or get rid of them?
I think, you know, at this point, what I would be certainly open to is eliminating them on almost a temporary basis. To allow the local governments right now to really make sure that the resources or that they have the resources they need to fund the services their residents need. So I would be open to eliminating them, but again, temporarily. I also would advocate for more creative funding sources for local governments. You know, one thing that I would push for is where could we potentially tax or what organizations could we tax that can afford it right now. For example, just yesterday, Seattle City Council passed what's called a Jumpstart Seattle tax, which taxes big businesses that have highly paid employees. You know, like Amazon would be an example of a company like that. You know, I would also like to see those types of measures where the businesses that could afford to help out during this time, we could try to get innovative in that space.
Well, yeah, that's a very interesting follow-up question. So you would be interested in alternative sources of revenue for local governments so they are not so tied and wedded to the property tax. Well, two potentials that are mentioned is broadening our 5% state sales tax to some now exempt products and services. That's one option. Or the idea of giving local governments and not just counties the ability to levy a local option half of a 1% sales tax. Would you be open? Would you consider either of those options?
You know, again, I would consider it. I don't want to certainly raise taxes for the individual residents. If we can raise taxes for the folks that can afford it, you know, again, businesses, again, I would be open to raising the sales tax and raising the sales tax too on more boutique services as well, something like that, where again, it would be people that could potentially be able to be in a position where they could more afford to pay a little bit more during this time.
Allie, when I interview legislative candidates from the Madison area, many of them have taken a position on the Air Force decision on F-35As. Do you have a position on whether we need more, we need the next generation of F-35s based at TRUAX?
I have a position and I am adamantly opposed to their placement here. I believe that I understand people's position for bringing them here from the economic standpoint, but I would like to see, let's do job creation in the green economy. You know, this does not have to be our solution to the shortage in our workforce. And second to that, though, we also know that at this point, the Air Force has decided on Truex Field. So as a legislator, you know, coming into this, they're not here yet. I would certainly do everything possible to advocate against their placement still. You know, I know our Representative Pocan is working very hard on doing that from a federal spending standpoint, and would be in support of that and educating constituents on how we can better advocate against their placement. I do not believe the fight is over. I think that their placement was decided in the beginning of the pandemic. And so given the current situation, I think we should continue this battle to not have them placed here, especially, and my main reason for that is environmental protection reasons. That is why I would not like to see them in this area. And so appreciate that question, because I'm happy to have a public stance on that.
A new subject. A study found that in 2015, out-of-state contractors were awarded $72 million in contracts for public works projects approved by local governments. That $72 million doubled to $146 million in 2018. So the question is, should bidding standards and requirements give preferences to Wisconsin companies when local governments authorize these major public works projects?
Absolutely, because I think especially right now, right, when we're seeing the rise in unemployment in our state, that if we can do anything possible to prioritize these contracts to Wisconsin businesses, that would be the best scenario. Now, the other point is there's a lot of outsourcing because, you know, people will say, well, we don't always have the skill set within the state to do certain projects, right? Well, I think another opportunity we have too is, you know, that's an opportunity for reskilling or providing training, right? For areas where we need more support, that's an opportunity for vocational schools, community colleges to provide training opportunities. So for individuals who are out of a job, we know that unfortunately some will not be able to return to the job that they lost. And so let's give people an opportunity to be educated and trained in other areas and provide those routes. So I would certainly like to see it more, prioritized to Wisconsin businesses.
Okay, got a couple of minutes left. Two questions quickly. Is there any other issue that is central to your campaign that I haven't asked you about? Can you think of any?
The only one thing, and it's just along, you know, we touched on equal rights from the standpoint of systemic racism. Another big priority of mine is equal rights in regards to the LGBTQ community. I'm a proud member and very much want to be a strong advocate for further protections and support for the community. So that is one area I would like to stress. But otherwise, you've hit all of my areas, so very greatly appreciate this opportunity.
Well, it's an open seat. It's a crowded primary. Quickly, why are you the most qualified person?
Yeah, I believe the area that I stand out, not only am I one of the few candidates that have worked for the state government, I'm also I've worked under both the Republican administration and the Democratic administration when I was working for the state, and believe that in order to get the policies that we want passed, we need to find a way to work together. And I believe that because of my experience with the government and my communication background too, my communication professionals background, that I have the best skill set to be able to, you know, really try to be an effective lawmaker in the state capitol.
Allie Marsh of Madison is a Democratic candidate in the 76th Assembly District. The primary is August 11. Allie, thanks for talking to Wisconsin Eye.
Thanks, Steve.
Thank you very much.
Campaign 2020 is sponsored by Wisconsin Hospital Association, Quick Trip, Wisconsin Counties Association, Wisconsin Realtors Association, and Wisconsin Operating Engineers Local 139.